Hey everyone, welcome back to A-Level Lessons Online. Hope we're having a fantastic day. Alright, we're going to be moving on to our part 13 of our Human Geography Team 2 series on the role of the state. Alright, so in the previous few videos, okay, more like videos or parts, okay, I've already covered what the role of TNCs are in society. And so now we're going to be looking at state, okay, which is basically the government, which is the next stakeholder in line. And then after that, we'll move on to your other organizations, like your international organizations and your NGOs, your non-government organizations. And then we'll sum it all up with non-state actors as well. So this part on part 13, okay, role of the state, is a very, very simple part. You would usually use this part as a form of... I mean, of course, it can come out as an essay on its own, but usually I prefer to use it, if I can, okay, in terms of using it as a synoptic link, or either that as a form of evaluation for certain types of essays, alright? So let's just go into what our syllabus requires us to know for role of the state. They have several functions that they play, and you need to know these functions at the back of your head, alright? It has to be crystal clear in your head, so that when it comes to essays, basically these are the points that you'll be using to drive your essay. Right. So firstly, let's go through the definition of the state. So it is essentially the government that is in power. So they are a very important player in shaping the world economy and development of a country. So we will observe in detail, okay, how what are the several roles that a state can play. But they are very, very important, right? Every single country out there has got a government. They have a state. I mean, of course, a country can also be called a state, but in this case, we're looking at state in the form of a government. So the government plays a crucial role, right, in ensuring that your economic needs are being met, your social needs and your environmental or political needs are all being targeted as well, right? So we will look at the various instances here. So firstly, we're going to be looking at the role of the state as a regulator of the economy. So a state has to be able to regulate global economic activities, and the state can implement several different policies which aid in the country achieving greater economic objectives. Right, in this point, we're looking more at how does a state implement several strategies or policies to ensure that they meet their economic needs, right? That the economic goals of a country are being met. So economic goals, we're going to be looking at efficiency, equity, economic growth, inflation, unemployment, right? It's a lot of things that we've learned in economics before. So firstly, you want to be able to have a strong government which can actually implement good trade policies, right? In today's interconnected world, right, whereby our society is so interconnected and everyone is basically relying on globalization to grow and improve their country, trade policies are crucial. They are necessary in ensuring that a country can take the next step, okay, to ensure that they level up, okay, as a country. So basically, what trade policies refer to, okay, is that a country or a state has to be able to pursue free trade in order to increase their net exports. Right? What happens is that in order to protect the interests of its domestic producers, there is a need for policies to ensure that they're able to export globally, that these domestic producers are able to export globally and earn from the significant levels of foreign currency. So here we're looking at a case of globalization that is working, right? When you have got domestic industries or domestic producers within your own country, you want to be able to make sure that their goods can get out of your country and be able to be sold, okay, on a global basis, right? You don't want them to just be solely constricted and restricted to your own market. It doesn't help the producers at all. And improving or increasing, okay, the amount of exports that are being exported out of your country would also help to not only increase boost, okay, economic growth, but also helps you to achieve balance of payments, right? Some of you guys may not know all these. It's all right. Okay, basically, trade policies help you to boost growth, right? So tariffs can also be levied on failure of imports such that it increases the price relative to domestic goods. Right, so this makes your imported goods less competitive and helps you to protect domestic industries. So when the state is a regulator of the economy, they also have to be able to protect their own people, right, in terms of the economic side of things, right? They have to be able to ensure that domestic producers, local businesses are not heavily exposed to foreign competition, especially with globalization today, such that they can still survive and make a living and have homegrown businesses that are basically as strong as the foreign competition. So some countries may choose to also pursue protectionism instead, which has got its pros and cons. You can check out my econ series for these kind of things if you want to find out more. But protectionism basically means that an economy closes off themselves completely from any sort of free trade or any sort of trading with other countries that are outside of its own borders, right? So protectionism can be good and it can be bad. Okay, it will definitely protect your own domestic industries much more because you're not actually letting foreign competition into your country. But at the same time, without free trade or without trading with other countries, definitely the amount of goods in your country will be lesser, as well as the room for growth would definitely be reduced as well. All right, so you look at different types of states, they would actually enforce different types of trade policies, which essentially help, okay, or target different types of economic needs within the economy. So the next one will be FDI policies, foreign direct investments. So foreign direct investments basically refer to direct investments from foreign countries that are poured into the country, into your home country. So these can be implemented to actually attract foreign investments from TNCs so as to increase investments and spur greater long-run growth. Right, when other foreign countries or foreign companies like your TNCs, when they actually invest in you, okay, as a country, when they put their plants here, their production plants, when they actually operate in your country, what happens is that it will definitely help, okay, in terms of the transference of capital and technology to actually boost your long-run growth, your economic growth across time. Right, so not only that, it can also help to support domestic industries or support foreign companies via incentives such as subsidies, access to capital. So when you have got FDI policies, you're not only looking at just introducing your foreign competition or your foreign investments, okay, from other TNCs and other countries, but you could also be helping your own domestic producers to bring in greater services, greater technology, greater capital that will help them to expedite their production process and help them to reap greater, let's say, economies of scale, or either that greater benefits, cost benefits that help them. So this is what investment policies are about. Last one would be in terms of industry policies. So this one is to encourage growth across all industries through regulatory policies. So this one usually requires good foresight by the state to identify a country's competitive advantage and provide support to grow these industries. So I'll give you one example, would be Singapore. Singapore has got a heavy focus on producing microchips, as well as a lot of these very tech-driven solutions or goods and services. So this is one competitive advantage that Singapore has, which the government actually builds on. Okay, and hence, there's a lot of business parks, your science parks that have actually come out, such as your Fusionopolis, Biopolis, which actually help in shaping a greater tech-driven side of Singapore, which helps the economy to grow even more. Right, so this is what we look at, or this is what we call, okay, an industry policy, when the state actually focuses on one entire industry and kind of like grooms them and grows them to ensure that they can grow stronger as a industry. Right, so this is where we will look at state focusing resources into these areas to ensure that the entire industry builds a very, very strong competitive advantage over other countries which may be producing the same good. Right. Lastly, it will be through the introduction of export processing zones. Right, this is kind of like a point that can be applicable to all different types of policies, right? Be it trade policies, investment policies, or industry policies. Because export processing zones, what they do is they actually attract your FDI and increases trade. So this includes things like free trade zones, free ports, which Singapore is notoriously known for, right? So what these do is they help to stimulate growth of the local industries to actually supply materials to foreign companies, or even to just supply domestically produced goods and services. So this will help in employment as well, but it does require strong infrastructure and constant support in the form of capital or investments by the state. So every time the state does something, there's always going to be an inherent trade-off, or there's going to be a cost that comes attached. So you have to recognize that while an export processing zone, for instance, let's say free trade zones, are very, very important and definitely very, very beneficial in terms of attracting investments, attracting capital, as well as to ensure that there's greater trading, you also have to be mindful that this does require high costs, right? It requires a government to be able to implement the relative infrastructure that's required for this trading to occur, as well as to ensure that there is support that's constantly provided in terms of your services, your electricity, all these kind of things, right, that is necessary as well. Alright, the next one will be the role of the state as the institution of last resort, right? Essentially, what this means is that the state is like the last line of defense, right? Every time it comes to any sort of issues here in society. So they have to first be able to deal with financial crisis if we look from an economic standpoint. So market failure is likely to occur amongst industries. So the state has to implement relevant and effective policies that correct such failures. We will learn this in econs a lot. What this basically means is that when a market in your country starts to fail, okay, because of inefficiencies, what happens is that this can cause it can cause like a domino effect, right? And it causes repercussions on your economy. So the state has to be able to implement policies that mitigate any sort of negative effects that come attached with it. Global financial crisis are also imminent. Let's say if there's a pandemic or there's any sort of issue that occurs in another different country. If your country is a country that is very reliant on free trade, for instance, it leaves you very volatile as well to experiencing recessions and global financial crisis. So the state needs to have backup reserves and prepare to tide through such crisis through their fundings, right? They have to be able to have enough reserves to ensure that these crises are dealt with. The next thing is that state also has to guarantee the stability of national currencies. Okay, this is more of a short-term and long-term issue to ensure that the currency is well managed, whether it be appreciated or depreciated when necessary. No one likes a country that has got a very, very volatile exchange rate. Right, one day your country can trade a piece of bread for $1, the next day it trades for $1 million. Right, this leaves your country very, very volatile and very vulnerable, right, to any sort of potential economic downfalls. So what you need to do is that as a country, as a government, as a state, you have to be able to ensure that you manage your currency very well, be it in the form of increasing exports when necessary or reducing it when necessary, or to either that tweak your own exchange rate relative to another country to ensure that your goods and services still remain competitive, as well as ensure that your currency is still strong or either that relatively stable in the global economy. Right, lastly is that they also have to be able to handle potential threats, be it social, environmental, economic. So for instance, conflicts, social conflicts, pandemics, environmental catastrophes, these are things that the state has to be able to prepare for, to implement the relevant strategies that ensure that these issues are either that mitigated or well adapted to. Alright, next is when the role of the state is a provider of public services. So public services include things like transport, education, housing, infrastructure and healthcare. So such services are often seen as too risky or unprofitable for private firms, right? That's why you see, usually when you look at healthcare or education, there isn't really a private firm that handles it. It's usually handled by the government. So the state must be able to well manage its fiscal budget as well as taxes and subsidies to ensure that every citizen has access to such public services, right? Because when such public services are actually provided by the state, by the government, it does come at a cost, right? You need to pay for healthcare, you need to be able to pay for your transport, for all the buses that you are supplying. So as the government, what do they have to be able to do is to implement the right policies that ensure that there is enough funding that goes into these areas. And in order to get this funding, usually comes from things like your tax revenue, or either that any sort of other way of gaining, okay, this sort of revenue that ensures that funding is poured into these areas. So this is something that's very, very crucial, and a government needs to ensure that they adopt, right, that they manage, okay, that we call it a fiscal budget, that they manage their budget very, very well and ensure that it does not dive into anything that is a negative. All right, so this allows them to actually provide public services, which are crucial because us humans, we need these basic services, right? Things like healthcare, education, which are all very, very crucial in ensuring one's living standards are being met, right, and ensure that there is a strong prospective future for generations to come. All right, lastly, is that we look at the role of the state as a business owner and investor. This one is actually quite straightforward. So this is when we have these things called state-owned enterprises or state-owned firms, right, when the state is actually directly engaged in the activities, the economic activities of firms. So some states have also become major global investors through their own national funds, known as sovereign wealth funds, basically funds that are used for investment in global companies. And other states have adopted certain services under the environment, such as state-owned firms. For instance, Singapore, your PUB, right, Public Utilities Board, that's a subsidiary or is under the Ministry of Environment and Water Resources. So over here, what we're looking at is when we're looking at states being a part of the whole production process, right? They become a business and they become an investor. So in different countries, they have got different types of ways of doing it, but the state has to be able to ensure that they can be able to manage such things. They if there's a good, right, that is, let's say, taking hold of the market and monopolizing the market, they may need to come in to actually own that company. And by doing so, that is how we have these things called state-owned firms. So the role of the state, right, sometimes is also in the form of managing these businesses, right? They have to be able to manage the businesses in the country and ensure that there's constant competition amongst the businesses, and that they have to step in, right, as a business owner if necessary, if one market has got just one sole monopoly that's dominating the market, or that to even invest in other countries, TNCs and all these global companies if they see a potential or any sort of benefits that they could possibly draw from it, right? So likewise, this one requires good foresight as well as good planning by the state, which is necessary to ensure that they are able to be a successful business owner and a good investor. So in exam requirements, very, very simple. Explain the various roles of the state, right? We've already gone through the various roles of the state. These are the main few that you need to know. And be able to explain and discuss the role of state in relation to other stakeholders in today's world. So look at their relationship with TNCs, right? Some of these global companies. How do they actually help these global companies by either investing in them or either that possibly even taking over some businesses themselves, as well as to look at how they regulate the economic activities that attract these TNCs and attract any sort of other businesses and global corporations that are basically going to help to spur economic growth in your country, right? End of the day, when you look at the role of the state, you want to be very, very mindful, right? Every country has a different type of government. Every single government or every single state would run the country differently as well. So different countries may require different policies at that point in time, which is why for the role of the state, you want to be looking very specifically at spatial variations in the effectiveness, right, that a state can basically carry out all these different roles, right? Different states, like I said, would have different capabilities, different education levels. So this is one thing that you want to consider, that not all states are effective and not all states are ineffective as well, right? Some states have done very, very well. Some states have done very, very poorly, resulting in poor living standards for the people, poor economic growth. So these are factors that you want to be looking at when it comes to discussing things on the role of the state, and be very, very mindful, right, whether the state, right, is really the true only power that has the ability to affect or change all these issues, right? Yes, they do have a very, very important role, but as we'll be discussing in the next part on your supranational organizations, right, we're going to be looking at international organizations and NGOs, which can also play a part, right? So these are basically the various stakeholders that you want to be discussing, right, at the end of this entire 2.1 series, be able to discuss how do they work cohesively together and what are the different issues or their different impacts that they have on society as a whole. Alright, so that is all I have for this part on role of the state. I think it's been quite a fruitful video, I hope, right? A lot of information. So go ahead and take your time, right? If you need to replay it a few times to really get a good grasp on it, go ahead. Role of the state is crucial. Make sure you use it as evaluation where possible. If not, that is all I have, right? So if you did enjoy this video, you did learn something, be sure to give it a like, as well as to subscribe to the channel. It doesn't cost you anything, it's free, and it really does help me out a lot as well. If you have any questions, you can leave it in the comment section below, I will answer them, or you can always head down to my Facebook page and my Instagram to just DM me a question, and I will answer them too. Alright, so if not, that's all I have. I will see you guys in the next part. Have a good one. Bye-bye.